In 1884-85, Giuseppe Ferrata studied piano with Liszt in Rome. While walking with Liszt to attend Mass, Liszt said to him, "Many students of the piano run up and down scales for hours a day, thinking they will reach the heaven of technical attainment. But athletes develop their muscles and get resistance and control of them by exercise based on sudden contraction and expansion. These principles should also apply to students of the piano, who should formulate exercises based on sudden expansion and contraction of the muscles of their arms and hands." Welcome to my tutorial on Chopin's Etude Opus 10, number 4. That's to say, sometimes the best place to start is the end. Perhaps you'd like to play this study, but have so far been put off by the formidable sight of that jumble of semiquavers and accidentals over 6 long pages. Perhaps you've listened to recorded performances and assumed that bravura closing section on the last page must be just too gruesomely difficult to play and have a life. These musical fears, understandable as they are, will soon fade away when you see for yourself how straightforward and logical the ending actually is. Once you see the underlying sequential pattern for yourself and find you are able to play it, then you'll surely feel confident about the rest, which is logical and a little easier. So, let's play. Notice the right hand plays the same pattern comfortably inside a sixth, and it just repeats descending a semitone at a time. Once you've got the feel for the shape of just one group of 4 semiquavers, you've got the best part of the whole of the last page. Staying with the right hand, put each group of 4 semiquavers into a chord and practice moving your hand as little as possible, up or down, backwards and forwards. Less is definitely more when speed is going to be a consideration later on. Back to semiquavers, but make sure each fingertip gets to touch the key bed properly with this exercise. Even take note of the other keys your finger sides or tips touch along the way, and repeat until the pattern is second nature. Then play as written, making sure each finger plays deeply into each note evenly. Now, the left hand. The solution to finding the right notes at speed is using a single root note from the octaves as a pivot for the wrist, in the same way as these scales sway left and right. This is the octave note. Your wrist isn't lost in mid-air, but attached to a familiar spot on the keyboard. If accuracy is important to you, attach your hand with imaginary superglue. To highlight what I mean, literally, let's glance at bar 4. The notes in red are pivots for the wrist. Holding onto them while you make the leap between notes really does help accuracy. Chopin used the same device in Prelude 24, notorious for those precarious and energetic large left-hand leaps, which are less tiring and the outcome more predictable, by rooting the weight of the wrist firmly on the highlighted notes. Apply this thinking to our octave section and you'll be surprised at how playable it is, after all. when some things new, such as putting the left and right hand together to help imprint a pattern, as well as give your brain regular rests, hold on to notes before you dive back in again. Even though you'll get carried away with the music as it reaches boiling point, remember to keep your wrists as flexible as you can and avoid any tension in your fingers or arms. To get the right muscular feel, shake or release tension with discreet movements before you play. Let it sound faster than it feels, rather than feels faster than it sounds. One more time. As the saying goes, do the hard jobs first, the easy jobs will take care of themselves. So let's look at the middle section, or bars 36 to 48. On first sight it looks confusing and extremely difficult. Bear with me and I hope you'll soon look at it in a completely different way and well within your capabilities. Once we're over this section, we're on dry land. This section is full of sequential patterns, the musical equivalent of potato printing. Here's the printed version of most of this section. To imprint the pattern more clearly in your mind's eye, start on the right chord and continue all the way down to the bottom of the piano. Bars 40 and 41 are the same, just a tone higher. Practice at first as chords, then as written, giving yourself a pause for thought on the fourth note of each group. In bars 42 to 44, there are three contrary motion scales. The first repeats. As with the broken diminished chords, they are modulated up one tone. Around the scales are more diminished chords with one inversion. They fit nicely under the hand with a slight turn of the wrist. They modulate upwards, beginning on these notes. And that's basically the middle section. As you can see, it has a clear pattern which repeats, keeping the same basic shape and distance between notes. If you imprint this basic harmonic chord pattern in your mind's eye, the semiquavers will fit nicely on top. At a fast tempo, semiquavers are too quick to think of individually. The chord shapes in their inversions will serve to guide wrists and fingers. The final musical effect will perhaps sound complicated to a listener, but you, the pianist, will be thinking in clear and simple sequential patterns. Some musicologists believe the inspiration for this study comes from a composer Chopin particularly admired,
J.S. Bach. It's thought the jig from English Suite No. 6 strongly resembles this study. I'll play you the first two pages, see if you agree. Here's another finger study in contractions. You might find playing it helpful preparation for Chopin study. Whether you plan to play this study in the near or distant future, here's a simple finger exercise based on this study you might find beneficial. In the past, pianists often practiced scales and exercises with coins on their hands to encourage the fingers to move as much as they need to rather than more. One way to begin practicing this study is to take the notes as written and, when they fit into a chord, which they often do, bunch them and play together. I'll play small sections as written, then the same thing as a chord. Let's remind ourselves of those pivot notes in red that help our hands bridge these wide stretches at speed. They can be practiced as written and, alternatively, as intervals, like this. Passages where the fingers play closely together, or contraction, can be played in various rhythms at first, each group having a pause for thought. When you feel confident of the notes, run them together in legato, aiming for evenness and clarity.
I'll close by dividing the first half into suggested practice sections and play them at tempo. Tempo is a matter of taste, mood, and experience. Your tempo is the one you can manage and enjoy at any given time, aiming to play all the notes clearly and evenly. Don't worry if that's not as fast as you'd like, you'll get there eventually. On listening, it's easy to forget this wonderful, dramatic and passionate piece of music is, after all, a finger study. Chopin composed it for you, and it's a work you'll find extremely beneficial technically and rewarding musically. So, thanks for watching and good luck with it.